Fine. Now, although we're great at individualists, I want to introduce everybody to everybody by asking people in turn to label themselves. That is, to try to compress their intellectual identity into about one sentence. The kind of thing I mean, I will start with myself for convenience and simply say I am a social and cultural historian of early modern Europe. I'm a fellow traveller of the École des Annales. I was a pupil of Keith Thomas. Now, I will call on you by name in an order dictated by the convenience of the cameras to do something just like that. Sally Humphreys.
I'm an ancient historian who then moved into anthropology as well, and now I teach ancient history and anthropology at the University of London.
Thank you. Ernest Gellner.
I'm personally advised in the borderlands between anthropology, philosophy and sociology.
Jack Goody.
I teach anthropology in Cambridge and work on Africa.
Edmund Thompson.
I'm a social historian, increasingly interested in social anthropology and Marxist empiricism.
Okay. Maurice Godelier.
I am an anthropologist and I am mainly concerned with economy and society, something like that, you know.
Maurice Bloch.
I teach anthropology in London.
Raphael Samuel.
I was brought up in the Communist Party Historians Group under Eric Hobsbawm and Christopher Hill, and I teach history to adult worker students at Ruskin College and work on mainly 19th century social and economic history.
Tom Bottomore.
I teach sociology at Sussex, and I suppose my main interests are in classes and in generally in political movements, and I'm a kind of Marxist.
Joel Kahn.
I'm a social anthropologist. I teach at University College London and primarily interested in Southeast Asia.
Keith Hopkins.
I'm formerly a sociologist, but my main interest is in the socio-economic history of the Roman Empire.
Arnaldo, Momiliagno.
Well, I suppose I am an honest ancient historian. Neither Warburg nor Marburg, but I'm a professor at the moment here at the University of Chicago, staying with those souls part of the year.
Thank you. Right, I'll now ask Sally to read her paper.
Well, I found it very difficult to decide actually what was the best way of looking at social change in a meeting of anthropologists and historians. And every time I tried to write the beginning of this paper, it came out different. And I said, what I'm going to say now is rather different from what was circulated. It did seem to me that it was rather difficult, tackle the thing in terms of what I call on the paper that was circulated, what questions about social change, what happens in social change. It wouldn't be very interesting to discuss processes of modernization or some post-process of urbanization, any of the kinds of social change about which people have tried to generalize, and that's my own feeling. And I thought that for various reasons there would perhaps be something to be said for starting from the rather peculiar kind of tangles that anthropologists tied themselves up in extreme functionalism through accepting a theory which seemed to make endogenous social change impossible. And that's why we have circulated a number of papers which spring from this problem in anthropology. And the reasons why it seems to me worth starting out from there in the discussion of social change between historians and anthropologists essentially are three. In the first place, as the extract from Brodel's preface to his Mediterranean book shows, the Annales school was heavily influenced by functionalism. This means that some of the most, in my opinion, important and original work done on history in this century has been very much influenced by functionalism. I think one can see in that extract that Bruegel is adopting what I would regard as a typical functionalist device for handling social change, that is, breaking down the social system into separate subsystems which can be treated relative to each other as external conditions to which the others have to adapt. And on the question of Marxist and non-Marxist theories of social change, I don't know very much about the relations between the Annales school and Marxism, but one can certainly see here that there is an implicit level of constraints in these three different timescales that Bradell talks about, namely that the scale on which things change most slowly, or in Brodel's own view, don't change at all, the sort of ecological infrastructure exerts constraints on the changes possible at the social structure level, and that in turn exerts constraints on the changes possible at the level of political history and histoire événementielle, so that there is a sort of hierarchy of levels there. And in the implications of the Brodel formula in terms of subsequent research, it certainly has meant quite a lot of attention focused on problems of demography, climate, infrastructure in various ways, particularly obviously in the work of Leroy Ladouille. And in fact, one can see also a difference between Brodel and Leroy Ladouille in the sense that Brodel tends to treat this sort of infrastructure as quasi-immobile, whereas Leroy Ladouille is very interested in the process of historical processes of change that go on within the climate, the ecology, and so on. Second reason, perhaps, for bringing functionalism in is that I think that quite few historians interested in anthropology are in some danger of falling backwards into rather extreme functionalist positions which have now been given up by anthropologists. I'm not referring to anybody here, but at the last meeting of this seminar, one of the things discussed was Leroy Ladouille's book on Montaigu, which is an attempt to reconstruct in a very functionalist way a picture of the society and culture of a medieval French village, drawn entirely from a series of documents produced by a historical event of a very conflictual kind, that is, the dualist heretic movement and the Inquisition carried out in this village, of which we have the records. And Leroy Ladouille completely ignores the historical side of this, doesn't talk at all about the conflicts, the manipulations and so on that one can in fact see going on in these documents. He simply uses them as a basis for a very static functionalist description. I mean, one can imagine if this kind of thing had been written in the by a sort of pupil of Radcliffe Brown in the 1930s about an African village in which was in fact going on at the time a spate of witchcraft accusations, which this anthropologist had totally ignored. We would now be using this as a sort of textbook illustration of what was wrong with functionalism. And I think that one could in fact use Montaigne in the same way. The third reason why I think it's useful to start out from some sort of consideration of functionalism, the functionalist notion of social structure and what its problems are when one starts to think about social change, is that in my personal view, structural functional analysis still is the most important thing that anthropology has to offer the historian, provided that it's not carried to the extremes that Leroy Ladouille carried to. And for that reason, I'm rather against Maurice Bloch's attempt to abolish the notion of social structure altogether, or nihilism. And it's for that reason that I'm suggesting that the topic which seems to me most fruitful and relevant for discussion between historians and anthropologists and between Marxists and non-Marxists at present is the question of how one relates the analysis of social structures to the reconstruction of the way in which actors in different positions in those structures perceive and experience and interpret them. In his book, The Revolution in Anthropology, Jarvie says that anthropological explanation is made up of, on the one hand, situational logic, which is pretty much like the notion of Verstehen as used by Dilthey Faber people, and the analysis of the unintended consequences of actions. And I agree with this, and it does seem to me that, on the whole, historians get better trained in their own subject in the use of situational logic than they do in analysing the functional interconnections of institutions. And that anthropologists get better trained in analysing the interconnections of institutions than in situational logic, and that therefore any, for various reasons, I mean, there is a convergence of the two disciplines on this point. Anthropologists are getting more interested in meaning, and historians are getting more interested in structure, and therefore this may be a profitable thing to talk about. It's this question of the relation between structural analysis and the actor's perceptions of structure, it seems to me, has always played a part in Marxism in the form of discussions of ideology, false consciousness, development of class consciousness, and so on. The papers by Maurice Bloch and Joel Kahn and Godelier are all dealing with this question in different ways. And it also seems to me a relevant question now when one's got so many oppressed categories of various kinds developing consciousness of their common interests and combining this consciousness with a claim to have history written from their point of view. Let's write black history, let's write women's history. As we've got Raphael Samuel representing people's history, I hope we can get him to say something later this morning about how he sees this question of the relation between a structural analysis of society and the way the people in it perceive it. Because of the kind of sources that we have for ancient history, which is what I do my own practical work in, my preoccupations with this problem of the relation between structural analysis and the actor's perceptions tend to focus around the problem of explaining divergences between the view of society that we get in one or another source, generally sources written by very individual individuals, people like Plato, and the divergences between this picture, which is practically all we have to go on, and the analysis I'm trying to put forward myself, which may very well not correspond. So this is a question which is comes close to the problem that Joel Kahn was discussing in his paper of the difference between the informant's view of social structure and the anthropologist's analysis. Except that the ancient historian has the additional difficulty of having far fewer informants. But I think that Joel and I are both trying to resolve this problem discrepancy by showing how the structure, as we analyse it, can generate the experience that the actors seem to have of it. And it seems to me that Maurice Bloch's paper is very relevant to this point too, because it seems to me that one can read his paper as saying, among other things, that rituals which express and affirm particular structural configurations influence the way in which actors perceive the society as well as the way in which anthropologists perceive the society. Well, I thought that as at least half a historian, I ought to try and give an example of how I would apply this kind of approach to historical data rather than simply discussing it on the theoretical level. I shall have to do this very, very briefly, I'm afraid. But what I will present is, in a very compressed way, is my own attempt to explain why Plato gives us a view of the relation between the economy and the political system in the classical Greek city-state, which I regard as misleading for modern historians and having been misleading for Plato and his contemporaries as well. It's also, incidentally, an attempt to explain the dominance of the political in ancient Athens in terms slightly different from Godelier's discussion of the same problem in his paper. What Plato says is people who trade and sell in the market or who make things for sale are unfit to share in government because they can't transcend their private interests and think of the good of the state as a whole. Therefore, citizen rights ought to be restricted to people who own enough land to make themselves sufficient. And furthermore, really the intrusion of private interests into politics is so dangerous intrinsically that the ideal type of government would be ruled by a guardian class who would have no private life at all, no property and no family. Well, the conventional interpretation of this, of which I published a version myself, which is more or less a synthesis of what other people say, says that during Plato's lifetime, or even rather before Plato's lifetime, Plato was born just about the beginning of the Peloponnesian War, 430. At this time, the Athenian economy was very rapidly changing. Trade and market exchange and money were becoming much more important. Politics was dominated by an urban rabble. Plato is regretting the breakup of traditional society. He's trying to put the clock back. He's also, of course, influenced by Sparta, where money and markets and so on didn't exist. And one can compare the situation with any sort of 1960s analysis of modernization and its effect on traditional societies by anthropologists or sociologists. My objections now to this kind of explanation are that it doesn't explain why trade and markets and market exchange and money were growing in classical Athens. It doesn't explain the dominance of the demos in politics during the Peloponnesian War. And it doesn't really seem to me to explain why Plato was so hung up on the question of the relation between public and private interests, because I find it rather difficult to see that part of Plato as deriving from Spartan society. We have really no evidence about the Spartans either way, but I rather doubt whether the Spartans spent a lot of time worrying about the relation between public interests and private life, and I would rather expect that if accusations of paying too much attention to private life were current in Sparta, they took the form of references to eating or sex, which were essentially the two things that you could go and do in an unregulated way in private, rather than staying in your men's house, eating your black porridge, and behaving in a proper Spartan fashion, rather than taking the form of accusations that private interests were being imported into the discussion of political matters in the assembly. The view, the analysis that I'm trying to put forward is that the growth of trade and market exchange in Athens is very largely the result of the high level of paid military activity through the 5th century from 480 onwards. That is, it's the result of the Athenian Empire's collection of tribute, which was then paid out to soldiers, rowers, who extended and controlled the empire. And that the demos interest in politics is also the result of military pay to a considerable extent. I mean, there's also an element, obviously, of enjoyment of the sheer drama of political confrontations in the assembly, but basically the Athenian assembly was in the position of voting for its own rate of employment or unemployment by deciding whether military expedition should be undertaken or not, and therefore it's reasonable enough that it should take a considerable interest. The separation of public and private interests, the concern over the question of how public and private interests should be related, seems to me also to derive from the empire, but in a rather different way. That is that from 480 onwards, with the collection of tribute, the state for the first time had enough financial resources to make it virtually independent of the wealth of its leading families. And this made possible the development of a new style in politics, pioneered especially by Pericles in the period between 460 and 430, with a great deal of concentration on formal decision making in the appropriate political institutions, and repression in various ways of attempts to make decisions outside this formal political machinery through private contacts. The most publicised form of these attempts to attack the use of private contacts probably being attacks on Pericles' rival Cimon for his well-known personal ties with the Sparta. Pericles seems, from what we know of him, to have had a sort of deliberate campaign of educating the assembly by rather didactic speeches about political affairs, a great deal of emphasis on the city, voting for what is best for the city, and so on. And this, it's been argued by Connor in his book, The New Politicians of Ancient Athens, was from about 430 onwards, subtly transformed by demagogues like Cleon, who start, instead of talking about the interests of the city, talk about the interests of the demos. I'm your friend, demos, I'll look after you. You vote for me and I'll see you're all right. As the war went on, you get a rising resentment among the rich in the later stages of the war at the way in which the demos is running, and the demagogues are running politics, especially after the disaster of the Sicilian expedition, which is seen as something, which you know that quite rightly, something seen as voted for by the demos because it would employ large numbers of people, give them pay, might well bring booty if it was successful. And then right at the end of the war, extreme resentment of the insistence of the demos and their leaders to continue the war when things were obviously hopeless. Two attempts at oligarchic revolution. This line put across by Cleon, I'm the one who has the interests of the demos at heart, is taken up by the oligarchs. The demos and their leaders are only interested in what is going in their own pockets, therefore they are not fit to have control of the city. They are simply trying to run the thing in their own private interests, with no recognition that, of course, the oligarchs were just as much moved by their own private interests and trying to stop a war which was bringing them more and more making them more and more heavily taxed the whole time. But presenting it, turning this weapon of accusation of just thinking about your own private interests, which was originally, in my view, directed against the leading, most powerful and wealthy aristocratic families in the state, is now turned round and used against the demos and its leaders instead. And it seems to me that that is the background to Plato's interest and concern over the relation between public and private interests, but that it's not sufficient to explain this just by saying that Plato and other members of rich aristocratic oligarchic families were fed up with a war which was meaning very heavy taxation. One has to see why this kind of separation of public and private interests seem plausible to them, and why they were unable clearly to see that Athens had an economy in which the most important piece of machinery, so to speak, was the circulation of money through collection of tribute and the payment of rowers and soldiers, and that in fact the level of activity in the marketplace did depend very largely on how much public money was being paid out in this way, and that therefore any attempt to say that what happened in the market was nothing to do with what happened in the assembly and shouldn't be allowed to intrude into it was simply misleading. But it seems to me that why this kind of theory seemed probable and plausible, not only to the oligarchs, but I think even to a considerable extent to the demos, in the sense that on the whole, probably people who wanted or were proposing military expeditions like the Sicilian expedition didn't say, vote for this because then you'll all get a lot of pay. They said, vote for this because Athens is a great city and we're going to make our great empire even greater. And there were conventions about what you did and didn't say out loud in the assembly, even if everybody actually knew what the economic implications were. And it seems to me that why all this is possible is that being in the assembly and being in the marketplace in terms of the actors' experience were very, very different from each other. The assembly was highly ritualized. It started off with prayers and sacrifices. There were rules about who spoke and in what order and what kinds of things you said and so on. Unlike Maurice's Malagasy oratory, Greek political oratory actually does involve a great deal of pragmatic decision-making, but it's pragmatic decision-making which has got a boundary of ritual around it, which is used to keep out certain kinds of arguments. At the same time, it's quite clear that the demos were aware in the way that they voted that voting to launch 100 ships in the assembly meant money in your pocket in the marketplace. But all the same, the way in which Athenian society was structured made it difficult for anybody to formulate the connection, formulate explicitly the connection between what seemed to be economical and what seemed to be political. Well, that, I realise, is a very, very, probably far too brief account. The kind of model I think it is a model of a relation between changes in the economic system and the generation of a new ideology, which I arrived at partly as a result of thinking about how an Athenian would perceive the structure of his own society, and deciding that he would see it largely in terms of different institutions or different social contexts which had their own norms and etiquette: the assembly, the temple, the gymnasium, the marketplace, theatres of war of various kinds, and so on. And he wouldn't have any sort of general theory which told him how these different institutions and contexts were related to each other, whereas I think perhaps a Spartan would have had a much clearer view of his society which stated much more clearly the relations between different institutions and the behaviour expected in them.
Thank you for being so admirably brief as well as lucid. We pass straight now to Ernest Gellner's comments.
Well, I take it I'm meant to be brief, which I shall endeavour to be. The country's figure falls into two parts, and I think the second one I can only comment on very briefly, not being a classicist. I think I'll concentrate on the early general observations about approaches to social change. I don't think I disagree with Dr. Humphrey very substantially. It's really a matter of nuance and stress. Now, perhaps one could begin by, she didn't use the word not, she said tangle, I think, was the word used to describe the condition anthropologists got themselves into through functionalism. Now, my view of the situation is much less pessimistic than this. I don't. I prefer to use the word not, which I think is reasonably equivalent to tangle, and I don't think there is a not. I think functionalism was, as far as it went, extremely useful, continues to be so, and there's no very serious problem about it, for the following reasons. Now, I was surprised to see Dr. Humphreys describe, I think it was evolutionism, as an answer to a what question. Now, it struck me always as very, very, very conspicuously an answer to a how question. What is true about evolutionism is that the what and the how are somewhat muddled. The essence of evolutionism, what I mean by evolutionism, is to concentrate on the line of development as the answer to the question, why is a society, or our society, or any society, the way it is? And the answer then is to trace a line, to trace it for the genealogy. Like, one way of looking at it is, of course, it's a survival of genealogical thinking. You explain the position and status of anything by tracing its ancestry and the way it's anchored to its point of origin. This is one aspect of it. But the reason why this is a great appeal, because at the same time, it seemed to be explanatory. It was the how and the what were conflated. I suppose the model for many evolutionists, of course, was Darwinism. And I suppose the appeal of Darwinism was precisely that a mechanism of change, natural selection, was conflated with a hypothetical story about how we got there. And the hypothetical story about how we got there was the replacement of an alternative story. We got there because we were put there in the first place and it stayed that way. So, and it was an answer to a stability hypothesis. But the two things got conflated. And the reason, what gave it an appeal, that it seemed to be explanatory, that it wasn't just... the reason why it seemed explanatory is because stability was taken to be self-explanatory, which is a dreadful mistake. Had we been put there by God or from the start, had species or societies been put there at the beginning by an extraneous force, it was assumed that consequently there's no mystery. Now, the great achievement, seems to me, of functionalism was basically a kind of shock therapy to shock people into seeing stability as a problem, to raise the standard of the kind of explanation that's required. To say, even if a society is stable, the manner in which it perpetuates itself is a problem. Even had there been a kind of sociological version of Genesis, had there been a story according to which the creator put a certain number of societies there at the beginning and then they stayed put, even had that been true, there would still be a job for sociologists and anthropologists to do. Stability is not self-explanatory. Now, admittedly, the way in which functionalism achieved this shock therapy was put in misleading terminology. What it did was, first of all, had a totally false theory to the effect that societies are stable. So a theory which was both false and contradictory, because they said at the same one and the same time, almost in one breath, I think the first generation of functionalists, that one didn't know what societies were in the past when you don't have records, and that they were stable. It was only, the contradiction was only camouflaged by saying it in different kind of ways. You didn't use the word stable means that it was the same N years ago as it is now, but the word stable doesn't actually mention any years and doesn't give any dates. So it's not immediately obvious that you're contradicting yourself when you say the society is stable and that you mustn't indulge in speculative history. But if you are, of course, to say stable is to indulge in speculative history, and it just looks minimal, it looks a kind of null hypothesis. If you don't know what the past is like, assume that it was stable. Well, it seems to me just as perilous a hypothesis as saying that it had evolved from a previous stage. It just looks slightly, perhaps more, slightly less exposed. It was a highly paradoxical way, it was a contradictory doctrine. It was ushered in this misleading kind of way, but its real achievement, it seems to me, was not in the in the slightly camouflaged stability hypothesis, but in the raising of the standard of what is required what is required for explanation by making the stability hypothesis was put in was really built into the method by turning by having as one's paradigm of explanation the contribution which any given institution makes to the stability of the total system. This is the paradigm of explanation. So it's not said as an open major premise, society is stable. It's on the contrary, it's a methodological rule of procedure that a good job done is to show how the pattern of succession or the inheritance procedures or the kinships or whatever it may be makes its contribution to stability. So that instead of having it as an overt major premise, it's built into your procedures of what is a good job done. Incidentally, the normal accusation against functionalism, that is teleological, seems to be quite invalid, because all you have to do is to read the thing backwards and it becomes straightforward causal. And the paradigm of explanation is then to show how any given institution contributes to stability and how other institutions, or its own features, dovetailing with them, help to maintain that institution in place. But once, it seems to be the achievement of functionalism was to raise the standard of what counts as explanation. The naivete built into the evolutionist approach, which of course was to take stability as self-explanatory. Functionalism, by concentrating on the problem of stability and quite wrongly insinuating stability as somehow a norm, a pervasive normal condition, by wrongly insinuating this rightly raised the standard. Once the standard is raised, there's no reason at all why the new raised standard of explanation shouldn't be applied to unstable situations just as much as stable ones. It seems to me that the valuable element in functionalism is retained. It's a kind of raising of the standard of what puzzles you and raising the standard of what you require for explanation. And then you can throw out this quite misleading and slightly absurd stability hypothesis and just leave it an open question. Some societies are stable, some aren't. And some are stable in different degrees and so on. So in other words, there seems to me no tangle, no knot, just a certain achievement which has to be perhaps, in which the superficial error has to be eliminated and the valuable element retained. From that, I would then proceed, where does one go next? The price of the raising of the standard was a kind of shifting, notoriously, and that wasn't a bad thing, kind of shifting to a micro approach. The raising of standard was achieved at the price of looking at one society at a time and looking very closely. Now, this is all very well, but this then reinforces, of course, the stability illusion. Now, it seems to me the time is now ripe for going back to the diachronic and comparative problems, getting kind of continuum in space and in time, which doesn't throw away anything of the raised standards. In other words, going back to the evolutionist and the diffusionist questions, but with a greater level of sophistication as to what counts as explanation. This is quite a big job to be done, it seems to me. I mean, the evolutionist approach, I suppose, works on a kind of ledger principle that you have to show at any given stage when a new thing was entered into the human ledger, but one and so on, into the accounts book. Once it's there, it's sufficient. Subsequent persistence poses no problem. Well, this is put in that way. It's an absurd principle, and the correct way to do it is to have a sophisticated approach to the ledger. There are various institutions or innovations have different qualities. Some have this ledger quality, relatively speaking, in that once somebody thought of them, they persist very easily, but even then they have preconditions. Now, for instance, I'm not at all clear whether one of the areas which is very interesting, which relates incidentally to your final bit of paper, is state formation. The Marxist approach to state formation is that something which had to start at some point once started goes on, whereas the fact of concentration, some degree of concentration of power is much less puzzling to others, or at least they're not sensitized to this problem. Now, it's not clear to me. The various ledgers have receptivity for various kinds of ink, and one has to combine the ledger principle, which underlies evolutionism, with a structural functional principle, which consists in a way of thinking what kind of paper retains what kind of ink. And there seems to be some features about human societies which are unpuzzling and generated without anybody having to invent them. Some of them have to be invented. Some, when invented, need special preconditions for their maintenance, with others are then maintained rather easily. Similarly, the diffusionist principle, the corresponding mistake to the ledger illusion, the sort of self-evident ledger, is the assumption that emulation is unproblematical. That all you need for something to get diffused is for one chap to do it and the other chap actually to see him at it, and that's it. And again, it's not stated as crudely as that. Well, again, it seems to be some things diffuse, some don't. And the merit of the structural functional approach is that it were to make one look into the micro mechanism which makes some things persist and some not. But then one has to return to this, to the diffusionist, comparatist, and evolutionist questions about how things accumulate, and the various great transitions such as state formation, which interests Marxists, or the implication of literacy, which Jack has been working on, and so on. That's really the substance of my sermon. I'm just some sort of marginal sort of annotations to this. I'm not terribly happy about respectful references to Marx. It seems to be strange to have to invoke him to justify sensitivity to conflict. I think one's perfectly capable of being aware of conflict without invoking Marx. I mean, the posing of evolutionist and kind of continuum questions, which seems to me valuable in Marxism, but the preoccupation with Marx's particular specific theses by talented and able and sincere people always seems to be regrettable. On the whole, seems to me to lead to theology and tautology, where there's a kind of option. You extract some kind of clear proposition from it, in which case automatically, of course, you're above the Marxist, or you refine those propositions and you add something which is non-vulgar, which is probably vacuous, because it incorporates so many qualifications. I think this is the point in which I'm probably in great disagreement with some of the people present. Either phrases like mode of production are taken seriously with the insistence on production and the implicit theses that the style of productive activity is somehow decisive, in which case, of course, one is a vulgar Marxist, or as one thinks, as I believe, the facts of the case require, one is sensitive to the fact that the means of coercion, I think Jack would call them forces of coercion, where are just as important, incorporates them, but then of course the whole thing becomes relatively vacuous. Why Marxism should have this hold on people, this endless, somewhat theological attempt to save it, as I suppose the question outside our terms of reference, and it's part of the sociology of the wider society. And I won't pursue it, but I'm not terribly happy about it. Marginally, I'm, again, to go on to these marginal observations, I think we're a little too kind to my friend Ian Jarvis, urging on situational logic. I think situational logic is a dangerous slogan. If the Marxists are always in danger of ignoring the forces of coercion, I think it seems to me the notion of situational logic leads people to ignore what might be called the Durkheimian or conceptual constraint of society. The idea underlying the situational logic approach is that you simply deduce a situation from what people aim at and what they believe about their situation, plus the way the situation constrains them. Now, the mistake in there seems to me that the assumption that the conceptualization of aims and the conceptualization of a situation are unproblematical. It ignores the whole Durkheimian problematic of how do they manage to conceptualize it at all, which is itself a feature of the situation. Aim formation, the whole sort of model of people acting in with clearly articulated aims and clearly perceived circumstances, it seems to me a kind of projection of a particular historical situation. Seems to me sort of heavily ethnocentric and so on. And I'm not nearly sympathetic to it as I think you are. Well, finally, just your final part of your paper, the discussion of the Athenian thing, I'm highly incompetent to discuss, not being classicist. I was fascinated by the sort of Keynesian account of Athenian imperialism, that in a society which can't print money or create credit in banks, because it hasn't got any banks, you can create credit and generate an economic expansion by gathering tribute from other states, which is interesting. It seems to be an interesting case of a kind of state formation. If the Athenian state had no collective treasury initially, it obviously lacked one of the attributes of what we normally consider state. So the byproduct of its expansion was a kind of addition to it of one of the political features which we normally associate with a state, but which it didn't have. So by that criterion, it was a kind of decentralized polity prior to this period. So the curious parallel to the effect of expansion by generating one further political institution because it acquires power over other states, it reminds me of the only sort of similar phenomenon I'm more familiar is when a decentralized nomadic society conquers others, it becomes a state unto them whilst not being a state internally. But the way they know, the way nomads who become a state to others when they're not a state in themselves react, of course, is suddenly become having been egalitarian, they suddenly become heavily centralized and create a kind of patrimonial state. Well, it's strange that in the Athenian context it hasn't worked that way, but on the contrary, the imperialism has not patrimonialized Athens, but democratized it. Well, these are just side implications of a highly uninformed person to be stimulated by those remarks of yours. Now, Mr. Chairman, I think I'll end at this point.
Thank you very much.
Now, before we proceed to the general discussion, I'm now going to ask Raphael Samuel to say something about people's history, hoping, incidentally, that this will include a reply to the question that Sally addressed you some minutes ago. If I could just remind you of the relation between social structures and actors' perception of social structures.
Yes, I'm sorry, I was perhaps overly impressed and stirred by the excellent papers that were distributed to us. So in fact, a few remarks that I prepared are really addressed in the first place to the general theme of the weekend, to social change, but I've tried to answer that question at the end. I just found myself wondering what anthropologists in flight from Durkheim and Radcliffe Brown would find in historians' accounts of social change, and an assumption that perhaps some anthropologists have that change is somehow the historian's business, and that adding a historical dimension to the determination of social structures would resolve the problems of equilibrium theory. But that it seems to me that history is no less problematical than anthropology, though it's a lot less given to self-questioning and self-consciousness. And I don't think that we spend much time examining the ambiguities of our favoured explanatory terms. And if an anthropologist were to go to history for an account of change, I think you'd find that we were in a sort of pre-Radcliffe Brown evolutionist condition in which explanations of change, focused on turning points, crises, single instances, particular conjunctures, historians being apt to fix on a particular moment at which everything is transformed. I think the merit, perhaps, that historians' accounts of change might have for anthropologists in flight from functionalism would be that we do seek for interior explanations of change for indigenous rather than exogenous causes. But beyond that, I'm not sure what help anthropologists would have. In English history, there's a recurrent elitist bias in historians' accounts of change, partly arising from the nature of the documents in which heroic individuals, ruling classes, creative and transforming elites in general occupy most attention, in which in economic history leading sectors attention is focused principally on leading sectors, and those parts of the economy which don't fit with that are apt to be treated as survivals, and you don't have such developed notions as the combined and uneven development which one finds in, for example, Marx's Capital in his account of modern industry, or that we have in the paper on Indonesia. I think there's rather little sense of in history of society as a whole, the kind of level of explanation takes place at a much greater distance from everyday life than you have in anthropology. Secondly, that historians' notions of ideology and consciousness often reduce to a rather shallow utilitarian notion of interests and of material interests. There's no, it's very kind of uncomplicated phenomenon. One finds this, I think, in Marxist as much as in, as well as in a non-Marxist history. If one thinks of a concept that's quite important to us in labour history of the labour aristocracy, the alleged elite of the working class in the 19th and 20th century, who by virtue of their of differentials or their superior position in the job market are thought to have held, indeed to have actually been the kind of responsible for major transformations in working class consciousness as a whole. And working class consciousness itself, I think, is sometimes seen as a little more than a bundle of particular interests. And thirdly, thinking of the weaknesses that you might find in our work, ways in which a predilection for positivist explanations, which I think comes partly from the fact that history is very much at the mercy of its documents, and that our explanations would tend to be at the level of those documents, and if the documents fail us, we wouldn't leave, as it were, explanatory space for things which aren't documented. As being asked to say something about people's history or oral history or the formation of consciousness, it seems to me that I believe that oral history can be a very great help in recent modern history, but I suspect that it's actually least helpful in the study of consciousness. I think there are, I think it's possible to find information about economic relationships, about work, about family obligations, to some extent about systems of authority in the family through oral history. But the one thing, well, it seems to me, it's explanations through oral history would be really perilous, is actually on the way in which people perceive the reality at the time. I think in general that the study of consciousness, therefore of ideology, is the most difficult of the historian's tasks, and that the evidence, whether in manuscripts and documents or in people's memories, is fugitive, and that the often the most that we can hope to do is to at least show the some of the sources that would have entered into people's consciousness. If one's studying an individual writer, I think it's possible through work like the Road to Xanadu to show the sources of imagination and reading of a particular individual. And I think it's possible to show the persistence and lineage of particular ideas, perhaps to show what kinds of traditions were available to people, and I think through the study of language, which can be a study in either in documentary sources or in oral history, one can get close to the meanings that people attach to some terms. But I don't think that there's any kind of one order of hitherto unexplored evidence which will resolve a question which is properly one of theoretical discussion, which is, I believe, the study of consciousness to be.
Thank you. Now, I suggest we proceed to a brief discussion of the remarks Raphael has just made, and then I will suggest, after a few minutes, that we return to the themes which Sally Humphreys raised and on which Ernest Gellner commented. Perhaps to initiate that discussion, I can just ask you, Raphael, a simple question, which is that you have written about the social structure of Headington Quarry, and when you did that, to what extent did you find that you could discover what that was by going to sources which your informants knew nothing about, and in what ways did you find the remarks that your informants made when you interviewed them helpful in reconstructing a picture of that mini society?
I think I'd want to think about that a lot, Peter, and would rather not answer.
Fine.
That.
We come back.
You wouldn't mind.
Would anybody like to make some remarks on Raphael's remarks?
I just wonder if I could make one short remark to link up all three.
With pleasure, yeah.
So first starting off with Professor Gellner's remark that somehow the advantage of the stability hypothesis in anthropology was that it focused on stability as a problem. I have a feeling it's exactly the opposite in many ways, because, admittedly, the earlier versions didn't, but once you take stability as an assumption, then what is stability, what causes stability or causes continuation or what causes reproduction stops becoming a problem at all. Then I'd like to come to what you said. You said that what I was trying to do was to abolish the notion of social structure. I don't think it's quite accurate. What I was trying to do is to try to understand what it was about, given the fact that I'd been convinced by most criticisms that it wasn't a description of, a full description of society, if that was ever possible. and that I, you know, I try to sort of see it as indeed one of the mechanisms for bringing about this stability. In fact, a possible tool for the continuation of certain forms of exploitation. So it's only because one can assume, you know, that there is a problem about stability that one can ask that sort of question. And if I can come to you, if I may, it seems to me that perhaps the problem with what you were saying about Athens, which I know very little about too, is that what you seem to exclude as a possible source for these, you know, the new thoughts of Plato, is the knowledge of another ideology than, or another source of ideas than those expressed in the council at all. In other words, the ideas of the demos. Of course, the reasons is obvious because of the reason that you that was pointed out, is that the only way you can have any idea of the notions of the demos is from the demagogues. But if one sort of thinks, you know, of the presence of an ideology in the demos, of which we know nothing about, which we can only glimpse at by the way that it must have been accommodated with in what the demagogues thought, because obviously they had somehow to articulate with it. And then to see, as you see so rightly, Plato as answering the demagogues, then it seems that one can bring in another element.
Sources of imagination and reading of a particular individual. I think it's possible to show the persistence and lineage of particular ideas, perhaps to show what kinds of traditions were available to people. And I think through the study of language, which can be a study in either in documentary sources or in oral history, one can get close to the meanings that people attached to some terms, but I don't think that there's any kind of one order of hitherto unexplored evidence which will resolve a question which is properly one of theoretical discussion, which is, I believe, the study of consciousness to be.
Thank you. Now, I suggest we proceed to a brief discussion of the remarks Raphael has just made, and then I will suggest, after a few minutes, that we return to the themes which Sally Humphreys raised and on which Ernest Gellner commented. And perhaps to initiate that discussion, I can just ask you, Raphael, a simple question, which is that you have written about the social structure of Headington Quarry. And when you did that, to what extent did you find that you could discover what that was by going to sources which your informants knew nothing about? And in what ways did you find the remarks that your informants made when you interviewed them helpful in reconstructing a picture of that mini society?
I think I'd want to think about that a lot, Peter, and would rather not answer.
Fine.
That.
We come back.
You wouldn't mind.
Would anybody like to make some remarks on Raphael's remarks?
I just wonder if I could make one short remark to link up all three. Is that possible?
With pleasure, yes.
I'm sort of first starting off with Professor Gellner's remark that somehow the advantage of stability hypothesis in anthropology was that it focused on stability as a problem. I have a feeling it's exactly the opposite in many ways, because, admittedly, the earlier versions didn't, but once you take stability as an assumption, then what is stability, what causes stability or causes continuation or causes reproduction stops becoming a problem at all.
No, no, that's not what you said. You said that what I was trying to do was to abolish the notion of social structure. I don't think it's quite accurate. What I was trying to do is to try to understand what it was about, given the fact that I'd been convinced by most criticisms that it wasn't a description of, you know, a full description of society, if that was ever possible. And that I, you know, I tried to sort of see it as indeed one of the mechanisms for bringing about this stability. In fact, a possible tool for the continuation of certain forms of exploitation. So it's only because one can assume, you know, that there is a problem about stability that one can ask that sort of question. And if I can come to you, if I may, it seems to me that perhaps the problem with what you were saying about Athens, which I know very little about too, is that what you seem to exclude as a possible source for these, you know, for the new thoughts of Plato, is the knowledge of another ideology than, or another source of ideas than those expressed in the council at all. In other words, the ideas of the demos. Of course, the reason is obvious because of the reason that you that was pointed out, is that the only way you can have any idea of the notions of the demos is from the demagogues. But if one sort of thinks, you know, of the presence of an ideology in the demos, of which we know nothing about, which we can only glimpse at by the way that it must have been accommodated with in what the demagogues thought, because obviously they had somehow to articulate with it. And then to see, as you see so rightly, Plato as answering the demagogues, then it seems that one can bring in another element.
Would you like to comment?
Yeah.
And while you're commenting, perhaps you could comment on Ernest Gellner as well.
Well, to start with what Maurice just said, I mean, you know, I wasn't. I hope that what you were saying in your Malinowski lecture was what you just now said you were saying. But it did seem to me that entire times in that lecture you rather gave the impression, you know, social structure is something that, you know, you sort of go off into the desert. You know, sort of once a month, like Dirk Heine and Australian Aborigines would do a bit of that, come back and go on doing real practical life. And, you know, the point I wanted to make was that the rituals very often around the pragmatic behaviour rather than being separated from it. And I do think that, I mean, it was very difficult to speculate about how people thought in Athens, because as you say, we only get one side of the question. But it does seem to me rather doubtful whether there was a sort of articulated democratic view which put together what was happening in the empire and the assembly with what was happening in the market. I think that the demos consciousness you know, was connecting these things perfectly well in the sense of how they voted, but that in most of the time probably the conventions of what you, how you expressed things in the assembly were maintained as the convention that one talked about the interests of the city rather than the interests of individuals, and that one attacked one's opponents for thinking only about their own interests were kept up. So, you know, I mean, I'm not denying that people can derive from their pragmatic interests a sort of practical understanding of how society works, but they may not get to theorizing it if their experience is structured in a way which blocks the theorizing, it seems to me. What I'd really like to take up now, I think, both out of Professor Gellner's and Ray Samuel's comments, is this question of situational logic and how one interprets people's interests, whether talking in terms of the interests and perceptions of individuals forces one to think very much in terms of practical interest, because when I was picking up this notion of situational logic, I certainly didn't mean to be accepting the sort of transactionalist view of that, namely, you know, which I think is completely, I mean, you know, either false or tautological. If you once start saying that people are always aiming to, or that all behavior is intentional and aimed at getting some kind of advantage from it, then either you define advantage in such a way that it's tautological, or else you define it in such a way that it's false. And what I meant by situational logic is much more the kind of thing that Weber talks about when he talks about the four kinds of rationally understandable action, means to an end, standing by ultimate values, custom, or emotional reaction. I think any of these can come under situational logic and do. And this is the kind of, I mean, and I would have said that historians were, on the whole, trained to use the notion in that rather flexible way. And I was a bit surprised that Ray thought that they tended to reduce individual interest and consciousness very much to material interest. I mean, I was taking it that one did build in as much understanding of the culture and the values of that culture and the kind of meanings and experience and perceptions that people would be likely to have in particular positions in it as one could reconstruct, which makes the theory in a sense rather meaningless. I mean, it doesn't tell you very much about what kind of interest, what kind of answer you're going to come up with. I mean, it just says that really the only way you can understand, you can explain people's behaviour is by trying to put yourself in their place and get as concrete an idea as you can of what would be likely to be going on in their heads, and then see if you can make sense of the thing. It doesn't get you very far, but it does seem to me what historians basically do.
Discussion is now wide open. Jack Goody.
Hi. Listening to Sally Humphreys' earlier discussion and Ernest Gellner's, I was a bit worried that we were going to get into a kind of binary approach to social theory at a high level, and that we were going to, in a sense, set up an opposition between what anthropologists can contribute and what historians can contribute, Marxists and non-Marxists, functionalists and structuralists on one hand, and those of us interested in developmental analysis on the other. There really isn't that kind of opposition that exists in that way in the real world, to which, like Edward Thompson, I'm attached, because anthropologists read history. Presumably historians read anthropology. There's no sort of mystique that one can get by being an anthropologist. I mean, simply because one teaches anthropology or one teaches history, there's no mystique about these different fields. I think in the way that, perhaps it's been suggested, I think my first having been trained by these arch functionalists like Evans, Pritchard, and Fortes, I think I wrote my first paper on penetration, on a note on the penetration of Islam into the northern territories of Ghana. And I didn't find any contradiction in discussing problems to do with change in one context and looking at problems to do with functional or structural analysis in another. Neither is any biologist, which after all is where the thing came from. I mean, people in biology discuss at one level functional analyses of particular organisms, and another level they discuss the evolution or changes over time in these organisms, and they don't find any kind of opposition between the two. I mean, it's social scientists, really, with what Levi-Strauss would call their primitive mentalities. Levi-Brew would call their primitive mentalities, and Levi-Strauss their savage minds, who see things in this binary way and create the problems which they then spend a great deal of time sitting around trying to solve. It seems the same is partly true of the problem to do with the I think, with perception of situational logic. After all, if you look at an arch-structural functionalist like Parsons, I mean, embedded in there is the whole of G.H. Mead's discussion there, which, if it isn't situational logic, I don't know what it is there. I mean, it's embedded and intrinsic, in a sense, to the system. And I think, again, one is really in the danger of making a sort of false a false antithesis in this way, and getting into the kind of situation some of us want to avoid, of a kind of cyclic movement between theories instead of a cumulative one. I mean, I'm certainly not in flight. I mean, to take up Raphael Samuel's point, I'm certainly not in flight against Durkheim, whom I regard as a great social scientist. And yet, I'm interested in problems to do with long-term social change. And I really don't see these as being in any sense contradictory. Nor do I think that the accounts which we've had of functionalism correspond to my experience of work of Evans Pritchard, who after all wrote tried to reconstruct the history of the Azandi state, the Fortes, who wrote on time and social structure, of Blackman, who was trying to write the history of the Zulu when he died. I mean, these people, or Firth, who went back to restudy the Tikapia after 25 years, I mean, these people were interested in aspects of social change there and trying to integrate those into their work. I mean, if you look at, I mean, I take one of the papers that was sent around where I think Ernest correctly suggests that one of the main features that held together these people, insofar as they were functionalists, consisted, he writes on page 90, essentially of seeking explanations in the interrelations of various features of society with each other. Well, that seems a pretty innocuous kind of a statement, and if all of us are not looking for the interrelationships of society, of aspects of society at one level with each other, I mean, it's hardly something to be in flight from. Those are your words, not mine.
No, I'm always good to hear first. Applying, not have a word. Words are okay.
That isn't something which is necessarily going to cut out explanations or looking at the thing in terms of a long-term longer-term sequences. In any case, I mean, the history of the past history of anthropology and a discussion on that doesn't seem to me to be very valuable, but it is worth remembering that a good number of these arch functionists were at the same time, Shapiro and others were writing, were attempting to look at problems to do with social change. So I think to sort of set up a binary situation here is going to be rather, you know, is a rather dangerous situation to get into.
Maurice Godelier.
Yes, I would like to comment on Jack Goody's comment and your comments. I slightly disagree with Jack Goody on the fact that there is no such thing as a mystique of the problem or discussion between historians and anthropologists. I do agree with him that, in fact, I don't consider myself as opposed to historians because I am an anthropologist and I don't share this belief. But I can give you some information about the situation in Paris. And basically, within the Annales school, because I know very well, you know, in fact, now there is a very big change. People like Brodel and others, Logoff, they are looking at anthropology to save history. Yes, to save history from something. It seems that just the sort of economic history, you know, with statistics on a long run, evolution of prices of bread in the 19th century and so on, all these beautiful curves and the use of mathematical models to explain history does not work too much. So they are back to anthropology to get a total view of a totality society. And what they pick up from us is the idea of totality, society as a totality. And what they take from us is an emphasis on ideology, representation that people have of their own life, of their own relationships. And now the weak point of history and the weak point of anthropology is just the same. There is no such thing as a theory of ideology. I mean, they look at us to understand better the way the people deal with sickness, life, representation of life, of reproduction of life, deities, and so on and so on and so on. Because we deal with ideology, we deal with religion, we deal with ideology of kinship, and so on and so on and so on. And so we look very much advanced, forward to them, because in fact it's now they have split history in so many little pieces, economic history, history of mentalities, and so on and so on, and they try to join now together all the pieces. And they know that something very crucial is to explain the way the people do understand themselves. Because as a Marxist, I have to understand, I have to understand first the way the relationships are organized, the way the people do think of themselves, and the way they act on themselves from the way they think of themselves. That is the dialectical social life. But the way they think of themselves is a part of the social structure too. I am not of this kind of Marxist, with a model of infrastructure, superstructure, and ideology, and I'm going to come back to this point this evening and to deal with this model, so-called Marxist model, infrastructure, superstructure, and ideology. That is too easy to get rid of that, But that is not Marxist, in fact. It's a way to call himself a Marxist. That is different. To call himself a Marxist is something, and to be a Marxist is some other thing. And it is contradictory, too. So I come back to the point. It's not so clear. There is something like a mystic of anthropology for historians now. Anthropologists, they look at anthropology to solve problems. And one of the basic issues is to deal with the representation of the people of themselves and the role of representation in the dialectic of change. That is a point. If you come back to the actual practice of the anthropologist, what do? We go somewhere, like Jack or anyone here. We go somewhere, we spend years, and we extract from personal informations, from personal relationships, with a few peoples, Ghanaian, Baruya, New Guinea, and so on, we extract informations, and after we write a book, and the book is not called a few information about the Baruya, but we write a book about the Baruya of New Guinea, and we transform personal information into impersonal compte rendu, review of a society. How does it work, the fabric of a society? Kinship, economy, and so on and so on. And basically, we solve contradiction in our work. Our work is contradictory, just like the historian. The work of the historian is also a contradiction, a living contradiction to solve, to extract from archives something and to deal with these problems. It's a contradiction to solve, You know what I mean, theoretically. So how do we do, anthropologists, to transform personal information into impersonal scientific view of a society? And so we have to deal with that. And basically the problem is that, to me, I don't deal with structuralism and functionalism and Marxism and so on like that. The issue is, when you get a society which maintains itself for centuries and so on, we have to understand if there is something like an hierarchy of causes explaining the stability and instability. Because, we all agree on a basic thing. Not everything has the same effect. And if you like it or not, we are all concerned with an hierarchy of causes to understand the function, the functioning of a society, and the evolution of society, evolution between brackets. And the difference between being a Marxist or not Marxist is to have an hypothesis about the hierarchy of causes, not the reduction of every cause to one, but an hierarchy. I mean, we have a sort of everyone, being a Marxist or not, has the same formal attitude. There is something like an hierarchy of causes to understand the functioning of society and the evolution of society. The society we know, the Baruya, England in the 17th century. And if you read Brodel's paper, it's beautiful. He's dealing with an hierarchy of causes, ecological causes, stable for two millennia, economic history, and events at the surface. So he's dealing with an hierarchy. He tries, as a scholar, to understand, to find, to discover an hierarchy of causalities, of causes. That's the main issue. Now we can play around with structural approach, functional approach, interrelation of features, social features. It is all right. We are all functionalists. We are all structuralists in some way. And so, basic point, what is the hierarchy of causes explaining the structure, the evolution of the structure, and the representation of the people over their structure. And to explain all these things at the same time, in one theoretical, within one theoretical framework, that is the challenge. I mean, that is the challenge. It is how I understand. It is why I comment on your comment, not strictly on your comment, but on your comment. But we shall go back to the points later on, I think. So.
Ernest Gellner.
I just want very briefly on some of those specific things. I entirely accept Maurice Godelier's formulation of what divides us, namely the hypothesis about hierarchy. This seems to me excellent because it highlights a very substantive and important point. Now, this is precisely, I think, what separates me from Marxists, and that it seems to me roughly speaking, causes fall into three important classes, to do with economy, to do with coercion, and to do with ideology. And it's precisely because I'm very deeply agnostic about there being any hierarchy. It seems to me which one of them is predominant is a very open question, and I'm very, very skeptical about there being a general hypothesis that one of these is in general more important. I do not know, but it's certainly both for the understanding of many traditional societies and in turn for the understanding of our own, to middle to late industrial society, the means of coercion seem to be more important, so that this is simultaneously a sociological and a moral political problem for a very obvious reason. But I very much welcome his formulation of it. It's precisely that point which divides us, and I think he formulated it correctly. Then the one or two other specific points which you raised against him. Was Maurice Bloch, I disagree on the impact. He said precisely because it was the stability hypothesis made stability undiscussed. Well, at the abstract level, this was so, I agree. And the general thesis, it wasn't even discussed because it wasn't presented as a universal thesis, all societies are stable. Had this been done, it would be made clearly absurd. It was hidden. It was hidden under the injunction, don't indulge in speculative theory, speculative history, which was formally equivalent, but didn't sound the same. Because what it meant, what don't indulge in speculative history meant, look at the society as it is, on the tacit assumption that it's stable, and see how the institutions contribute to that stability. At the abstract level, it didn't stimulate discussion, and when ultimately it did, when functionalism migrated from anthropology to sociology through Parsons in the post-war period, then of course there was kind of ideological capital to be made. People thought they could make their intellectual reputations on suddenly discovering conflict. And there was an outburst of people discovering conflict as if it was something new. At that level, it wasn't particularly fertile. But at the micro level, it seems to me to be enormously fertile because by tacitly assuming stability, it will just go and look precisely how the institution works. Instead of assuming, incidentally, this is my disagreement with Jack Goody, where he quoted the thing about looking at institutions and said, well, what's new? Well, it was new once upon a time, because people assumed that institutions just had a kind of inertia like physical objects, and if they were there, they were there, and this didn't quite explain. The only thing we need to explain is who thought of them first and initiated them. And the achievement of functioning was precisely to make people not look at the origin of institutions on the irrelevant grounds that people we didn't know about the origins, but in a fertile way make them look at what sustains them. But this is a familiar story.
I didn't mean to say that it wasn't new. What I meant to say was that having come in, it wasn't.
Oh, by now, it wasn't by now. Sure.
It wasn't something that we were in flight for.
I think there are two dangers to take your cue away by polarized thought. There are two dangers for anthropologists. Some think that functionalism is something dreadfully new when it came, and ignore the fact that it was a commonplace of conservative political theory. And then equally it's dangerous to say it's always been with us. And finally, on the point of situational logic, of course it isn't only
quite right. You said, as you said, it didn't only the Marxists were in danger, either had the best links between a vulgar theory which is false and a refined theory which is vacuous, because it is equally true of situational conditions, so to speak. I still thought the transactionalists are not the most important specimen. The most important specimen of situational logic people are economists. The whole of economic theory is based on this kind of thing. And of course, you misled me in a way by Ian Jarvie takes over that tradition. And the idea is the way to proceed in such times is assume that people are clearly articulated aims, a picture of the situation, and then allocate their resources, their energy, their time, and so on, in terms of the priority they give to their aims. And their assessment is attributed to the circumstances. Now, on this point, I happen to be Marxist. I think that this way of looking at this is called accountant's way of looking at things. Something specified on which you maximize. And circumstances. This is a extrapolation of a special type of economic organization, and a very privileged, very untypical situation which prevailed in the early 19th century and thereabouts, a bit later and a bit before. The very untypical situation where, for very specific historical circumstances, the economy was separated from the polity. Where, in other words, people could attempt to maximizing their profit without looking to their safety, where they could think of people as workers and employees rather than as kinsmen, allies, political dangers, and so on. This seems to be untypical. It's not true of previous periods, it's no longer true now. The very untypical situation, the historical precondition of which can be specified, misled both the classical liberal economists and Marx, and both of them exaggerated this highly untypical situation, and it still echoed through the classical economists, and of course through Popper and Jarvie and so on. Given the fact that you invoked and Jarvie, thought you meant that by situational logic, and I know Popper and Jarvie mean that, and that doesn't seem to be the right approach. By the time you say you incorporate the way people are conceptually constrained, by that time it will become totally harmless.
Mm. Yeah, I didn't really read Jarvie that way. I mean, I thought I really was laying much more emphasis on the whole sort of conceptual system rather than the actual aim of acquiring the cargo.
Well, to paraphrase what Lasky used to say about Marx, you read Jarvie in your way, and I read Jarvie in Jarvie's way.
Arnaldo, Momiliagno, and then Maurice, Godelier.
Well, what I wanted really is to pick up a small point of what Sally said, because it seems to me, in the second part, because it seems to me to imply some general problems about the stability of society, and also to connect itself with what Gellner was saying in his last remark. It's obvious that in Athenian democracy, when you voted war, you certainly voted to create an income to the demons, but also, equally obviously, you voted to create a certain number of dead people or a certain number of prisoners by decree. Now, there is here, an obvious distinction in Greece. In the 5th and the 6th and the 5th century, or the great part of the 6th and the 5th century BC, you more or less imply that by doing that, you would not put in jeopardy the state as a whole, that is, that the society as a whole would not be affected. You would have a certain number of individual deaths, which you could not, of course, mention before, the names beforehand, but nothing more than that would happen. What, of course, the people discovered in the Peloponnesian War was that there was a danger of going back to the situation which was quite normal in previous times, when the Messenians were transformed into heroes by the Spartans, that you would have collective death or collective slavery. That is, that there are certain points in society in which you make decisions in which the whole stability of the society, or in fact, the whole life of the society, as a collection of individuals, is at the stake. And that was, of course, the normal situation in Assyria, or to a certain extent in Israel in the earlier period. The point about this is that you have a certain type of decision in these cases which affects the whole life of the society, which seems to be taken when that happens in the most
I mean, looking in Weberian terms, the most unrational ways. That is, I can see, for instance, in Athens themselves, in Athens, with the Athenians themselves, but we could see that in other societies, say, what the Jews decided in 70 and AD. I mean, to take decisions obviously have as a consequence only the destruction of your society, or even the collective death of a very considerable number of the members of your society. Now, what I wanted to ask Sally is just that. I mean, what is our consequence in the analysis of stability of society if you have to make a distinction between decisions which fundamentally do not affect, at least in the mind of the people who are taking them, the stability of the society itself. On the contrary, other decisions which quite clearly in the minds of the people who are taking them affect the stability of the society and indeed the life of the society.
If you want to answer that, or shall I ask Maurice to make the next point?
Well, I would have thought that what happened in the late 5th century in Athens was that some people in the society thought that the decisions being taken affected the stability of the society, as a whole, and others didn't, and that the ones who thought that the stability of the society was threatened did in fact take revolutionary steps to overthrow the decision-making process for that reason. But
yeah,
I'm not convinced that all of the
Yes, indeed, I would agree entirely with you in this particular case, but that would seem to me is exactly the type of situation in one has to analyze, in which there are people who think that what you're doing is simply, I mean, you know, to make a slight change in the situation, and there are the people who realize on the contrary that what you're doing is, I mean, just to put in jeopardy the whole of the society as such. And, I mean, this is, of course, the same situation in 70 AD. I mean, there were certainly people who knew that perfectly well or not. But it would seem to me, that, I mean, at least for the period of history which I know, that this type of decision, or distinction in the process of decision making is to be made. And this, I mean, in concretely, is very important between. This is at the conscious level. I mean, and then there are, of course, other problems about what happens at an unconscious level. But I'm simply now speaking here, I mean, of what. The more you have the death of life, the decision making, the less reasonable, I mean, in retrospect, people seem to be.
Maurice, could you do?
Yes, I would like to comment on Ernst Gellner's comments. I don't think, like you, that the model of interaction is just a projection of our society, a sort of ethnocentric view, you know, people. Yes. I mean, I do think that in any society, the people they do act in order to maximize something. And saying that, I am not a partisan of a formal approach of economy in economy and so on. I do agree with Fur, for instance, when in the preface of his book on primitive Polynesian economy, the 64th, written in 64. When he was dealing with substantivist and formalist discussion, he said, I cannot understand this discussion because the formal theory of economy, I mean, people trying to decide and to maximize something, I find everywhere and I have found within the Tikopia structure. I mean, maybe I misunderstood you, but it is always wrong to emphasize on the ethnocentricity of this model. I mean, interaction and maximization. I don't see any ethnocentricity there. What I see ethnocentricity somewhere. It is when you have said that, you have say nothing about economy. It's just because no economist as such is using this model. This model is not used by any economist as such. I can show you. I use Samuelson's textbook on economy. It's not a Marxist one, I think so, no? And after giving the definition, formal definition of economy, he starts with monopoly and oligopoly and so on. So he introduces from the outside the real structure of the real world he's dealing with. It has nothing to do with the formal theory. He's introducing the social structure, capitalist economy with monopolies or without monopolies and so on. So after saying something nice about formal behavior, formal rules of behavior, he introduced social structure. And he understands the formal behavior within a social structure. And he does not care with trying to understand both things at the same time. You know, it is easy to see there is no such thing as formal theory. It's a formal statement, and after you do something else, and you mix. It's very easy to study the structure of the theoretical structures. Now, once you say that, so the ethnocentricity is there. After saying something nice about maximizing, behavior, you say something different, and there is ethnocentricity. For instance, to me, a Greek or a Baruya, or I don't know which man, is not producing goods or material things. He's not living to produce material goods. He's producing to reproduce himself as a citizen, for instance. I mean, there's no such thing as material interest as such, even in our society. The workers are not dealing with, and the capitalists are not dealing with material goods. They are dealing with profit. It's money, and money is much more than just material things. It's power, it's many things else. I mean, there is no society in the world where you have material interest as such. It does not exist. I mean, people in the antiquities, they were trying to reproduce themselves as citizens, for instance. To reproduce himself or as a citizen is to do many, many things, not just to produce goods or to get money, income, and so on. You know, it is to reproduce a status within the society, and so on and so on. It is to reproduce the society itself. So that is very important. I mean, discussing about reducing everything to material interest, I don't know, maybe it is what you call theology, you know? But it is a bit curious to be, you don't give it much chance to the Marxist. To be a Marxist is to be either a vulgar materialist, and so you don't care, me too, or is to be to fall into a trap, a vacuum. So you don't. I am not so sharp with my adversaries, you know, because I do use a lot of works, and they are not Marxist works, and they are not empty too. I mean, they never play with such an opposition between being empty or being vulgar, you know. So there are the two points, you know, I want to make, you know, about interaction and maximization behaviors, and to me it's formal and it is not ethnocentric. There is ethnocentricity elsewhere, and I can explain where. And so the second thing, there is no such thing as material interest as such. It's not a Marxist statement. What I have said about people don't live to produce, but they produce to live and to reproduce their own status, it's Marx who say that in Forman, the book in 1857, it is not me. And any anthropologist could take that for himself. It is the way Marxism became a sort of theology you are fighting against. But I don't think Marx was a theologian, but we can agree, disagree about that, you know.
Edward Thompson?
I wanted to revert to earlier, a more general question that's come up, I think, several times, which is the use of the word society and societies. I think this may indicate a certain purely empirically locatable difference in the way some historians, some anthropologists think. But I find it always very difficult. I always have to check myself and say, what is this thing, this society? Whereas there seems to be a tendency in some anthropological thinking to say, well, there is a society, then we know what it is. And historians find it very difficult to say what this is. When you ask Raphael Samuel,
how he would set about describing the social structure or the society of the Headington poets, he backed away from it. Now, I don't know why he backed away from it, but I could see myself backing away in the same way if you'd asked me about my early 18th century forest communities. I would tend to prefer to use the word community describing this than a society, because the question would be raised in Headington or in Windsor Forest, are you dealing with a parasitic society, parasitic upon another larger society, or a marginal society, or is this characteristic of a larger society? And then you might be led, if you began to look at the larger society, into lines of argument that Wallerstein or someone gives us, in which you're beginning to see this as part of a world economy. And then you're led to the question of, are you to see this society as it's perceived conventionally in the newspapers, by the magistrates, by the police, and conventional opinion of the time, or as it's perceived by the majority of labourers or foresters of the time? And the perceptions will be very different, and the second will be very much more difficult to recover historically than the first, and the techniques and methods used will be very difficult. Or are you to say that this society can only be seen by putting together opposed views of self-perception within that society? Now, I think in my own, just as a sort of comment upon my own work, and I think many other historians share this, this is probably an improper comment to make on your paper, but because I'm really talking about something rather different. But the questions, what, why, and how, are very often not the questions in one's own historical work one is asking so much as who and whom. And I think one has to put those questions together with your questions. I put them back at Gellner, too. I mean, he tells us with some confidence that he knows there are three causes, which are economic, coercive, and ideological. And I would say again, who, whom, that all those causes in the societies that I study operate are operative within societies which I cannot study without some concept of contradiction and some concept of class. Now, I don't think that the kind of concept of contradiction and the kind of concept of class should be taken as a universal and should be then read back and imposed. And I agree very much with what Godelier said in his paper about not reading back contemporary or modern concepts of contradiction and class. But nevertheless, that is the kind of problem which historians are always dealing with. So that to deal with a society, one tends to be offered, as a historian of the last 300 years, say, various alternative ways of doing it. One is the positivist way. Of course, we all know what a society is, and we can count it, or we can find a positive, objective, quantitative criterion. Now, the problem about this is that it can often mean that you can describe a society independent of how that society is perceived by the people who live in it. And this I would certainly reject for reasons which I don't think I have to argue here, but I can certainly say I would very, very strictly reject this. I don't think you can talk about a society independent of people's consciousness and perception. I do not think you can talk about a social structure independent of the categories and concepts which govern that social structure any more than you can talk about money independently of the categories of money itself. So too often, the sternest and most rigorous attempt to describe in a positivist way, a society independent of how it is perceived leaves us with something that is not that society. And another alternative, of course, is to then adopt a structuralist solution, which is to establish a model, however sophisticated, of the structure of that society. And this can involve us in the central problem this seminar is discussing, precisely the problem of change, of once you've established this structural organization. So I want to end with a very banal comment, very banal comment indeed, which is that I was terrified by all the theoretical thunder about 10 years ago into believing, like many of my more advanced historical colleagues today, that the most stupid form of history was, événement, was narrative history. And tended, in my own work in the last 10 years, to opt for a more themal organization of my work, sometimes the themes being selected, in a sense, by preoccupations of social anthropology. And I now come to the view that while this is a very fertile and useful thing to do, in the end, the most exacting, and I mean analytically exacting, account of the process of change can only be embodied in the fullest scale in narrative history. I don't mean empty narrative history, mm-hmm. but I mean analytical narrative history informed by this conceptualization and self-consciousness about it and themal organization of it. But in the end, you have to put those things back together, because a structure alone is not the same thing as the actual eventuation of history itself. Yeah. And only when you consider it operation, then I think we have to then examine once again and think again about what we mean by historical logic, what historical logic is. Well, this is too big for me, and I'm not competent to really try and talk about this, but in the sense that in modern history, since change is very rapid, and much more rapid than it is in certain earlier societies, it is, although a very imperfect laboratory, a continual laboratory for testing concepts. Because if A, B, and C are related in these ways and not in other ways, historical logic will suggest that they will give rise to D rather than to F, G, and Y. Now, your logic may be faulty, but other historians can play it back. And this, I think, is what one is doing all the time. One is saying there is this structural organization of society. That is why the event, analytically examined, eventuates in D. And then other historians will come and examine that logic in the light of their own empirical investigation to see if another factor, F, has been looked out, a contingency has been left out of this examination which alters the whole logic.
To what extent and for what reason would you give an account of change over time with concepts which contemporaries would not have used?
Well, I'm much preoccupied with this all the time in the question of class, because I think we use class in two quite different ways. And I think when I'm talking about the making of the English working class, I am talking about something which actually has an observable empirical content. If I'm using the concept of class in dealing with 18th century plebeian culture, I'm using a heuristic concept, analytical concept, without which I cannot explain. But it is not empty of empirical content. That is, in the sense that if riot performs this kind of function, if the hegemony of the ruling class can only be held by this kind of modulation of permissiveness and terror, this can be explained only by seeing a polarization, a field of force within that society, which we call class. And that is the empirical content, that is the examination of the actual events and mediation of social relations as observed. But I'm very much aware of this problem. I think probably historians must increasingly become aware of this problem, that one often has concepts which in one position may have an empirical, manifest empirical quality, and in another position are heuristic. And people get confused. One moves between these two uses and often is self-confused by it. I'm sure I have been.
So you'd make a conscious choice between alternative conceptualizations like classes and Stände at every point in the result?
I think one should, yes. I think one should become self-conscious of this, yes. And be willing to justify it, yeah.
No, it's good.
Yeah, to come back to the point about class and the concept of class, last year I've been trying to trace the origin of the concept, So I went back to the French economist in the 18th century. And curiously, you see people like Turgot and Quesnay, the physiocrats, and Quesnay is a nobleman. He knows perfectly about stand, you know, orders, social tiers état, noblesse. And he writes a book, Economic Tableau of France, with three classes. And after, it was in 1759. And so I went to read Smith. He came to Paris, he talked to Quesnay. He wrote a book and he used classes. And after I went to Ricardo, 1804, and he used classes. And all these people, they knew perfectly about nobility, peasants, and so on as orders. So how these people have been able to use, to trace, to build up a tableau, you know, a view of France, the new economy of France, to use classes instead of orders. So, well, I tried to check and I discovered that the definition is given very clearly by Quesnay. I call class any group of people linked to means of production, something like that. So he was, in fact, getting rid of the old structure of a society. To him, it was not operating anymore to define the economic basis of a new society. So he knew perfectly about orders. And so I went back now to the German ideology, the book of Marx, and I saw for pages and pages Marx using orders and classes. And I came back to the manifesto of Marx, 1848, and Marx uses class to speak about the patricians. But he knew perfectly the patrician, the equites, the chevalier, I don't say in English, equites, or the craftsmen. No, the equites in Roma.
The
knights and so on. He knew very well they were not classes. How Marx could take orders for classes and classes for orders. I can give you a list of quotations in which he makes a very clear distinction between class and order. And other quotation he takes class for order or order for class. So Marx was wrong. Oh, he was stupid. He was the most stupid fellow. And in fact, you understand that there were two concepts of classes. Two. And it's very now interesting to look at books of a sociologist about the concept of class. In fact, Marx is using the concept of class in two ways. First way, just like Smith, Ricardo, Quesnay, and so on. I call class a group of people defined exclusively by economic relationships. And he said it does appear only with capitalist society. So you cannot use the concept of class for antiquity. Stricto sensu, you cannot use the concept of class for an African kingdom. You cannot use the concept of class, stricto sensu, for there is no class in antiquity in some way, in this sense, in this meaning. But after he used class to say something different, to say something discovered through the analysis of the capitalist society and class struggles in capitalist societies. And I can give you I did not bring my paper, it is going to be published now, it's about the concept of class in Marx, it's amusing, you know. And the second, so he used class to say that orders in the antiquity, order, they have economic foundations and they involve political and economic domination. Domination, oppression. So that is different. He used in two ways the concept of class, in a very specific and empirical way, applied to our society only, I think. And he used for the medieval ages, for ancient Roma and so on, even for the Incas, he uses the term of class, not because he wants to project our ethnocentric concept of class, but because he wants to say something about the foundation of social life. I mean, these classes in the antiquity, they had economic foundation just like our classes. These orders had economic foundation. It is why I call them classes. And they were antagonist social relationships. They were involving conflicts of interest between bracket and oppression of man by man. It is why I call them classes, and I can give you now the demonstration, because otherwise Marx was the most stupid man using classes to deal with things he knew very well not being classes. And it is, I am surprised to see so many people writing on the concept of class and never going back to the text. And Marx says, I have taken the concept of class from two groups of scholars, the economists, the historians. I went through the economists, but I never went through the historians. But probably you know better about the historians of the 18th century. I don't know, in England and in France. But I know something about the economists in England and in France in the 18th century. And so it would be interesting to have an historical view about the use of historical concept like class. And it is also at the same time a theoretical view. It's not just an historical history, it's a theoretical history of theories.
Thank you.